My name is Sophia Hagelnani Albov, and I am a doctoral student in the Denby doctoral program, which is the interdisciplinary environmental sciences program. And I study agroecological transformation in the context of the Finnish countryside. My particular project deals with a bounded geographical region, which is called Paloporo Village, about 6 kilometers south of Hyvinkää. And in Paloporo Village, we are doing some really interesting experimentation with how to build a sustainable and resilient agricultural system that steps away from the globalized food chain and instead builds a cyclical local food system. In addition to building the cyclical local food system, we're also working on tenets of a circular economy, because this food system is a system which produces biogas in addition to food production instead of supplanting food production. One of the big problems with agriculture that's premised on circular economy and the production of biofuel is often the agricultural products that are used to produce the biofuel are supplanting food production in the region where they're being produced. For example, corn, which is being used toward biofuel, is supplanting the production of actual food for nutrition as opposed to food for energy. So that corn is all being used toward energy, which is creating sustainable fuel, but it's not necessarily creating sustainable agriculture, and it's disrupting the creation of localized agricultural systems. So in Paloporo and in our model, which is called Agroecological Symbiosis, which from here on out, I'm going to call AES. So in the Paloporo AES, we're producing this biofuel and we're supporting a localized cyclical food system. And the way we're doing that is modeled on the industrial symbiosis model, which is the cooperation entities that are in spatial proximity. So for example, in our case, farms. So two farms, which are in spatial proximity, are collaborating together to turn waste into usable product toward that biofuel. In our case, the three main farms that are cooperating are a grain farm, an organic vegetable farm, and an organic hen house. So the grain farm uses the green manure lays, and then it also uses the manure from the hen house to feed the biodigester to produce the digestate, which turns into the biofuel. In this, we're still able to produce the grain, which is then used for production of flour and bread that is then resold to the local community. One of the things that we've been dealing with a lot in our project is what is actually local and what does local mean? And this is a big question that faces a lot of circular economy systems, because what is the actual extent of a local production? And this is one of the questions that I'm trying to answer in my research from a sociocultural perspective. So in my research, I'm talking to the consumers that are buying that flour and that bread and who are using the farm area as a social space during market days, and talking to them about what their geographic imagination of local is. So there's a lot of different questions of sustainability and sustainable transformation that are contained within this singular AES model. We have the biofuel questions, we have moving away from the globalized food chain, and then we also have these questions of consumer perception of what is actually a local product. So why are we trying to do the AES? What is beneficial about the AES model? And why is the AES model premised to be a sustainable solution for the Finnish countryside? In the globalized food chain, there isn't the recycling, and there are a lot of middlemen, which makes a lot of murkiness between the point of production and the point of consumption. But in the Paloporo AES model, which we think is able to be scaled and adopted in other contexts than just the Finnish countryside, what we're trying to do is really increase the transparency between the point of production and the point of consumption. So we want to create a transparent system from production growing the food, producing the food, and then ultimately the consumption of the food. So the increase in transparency is achievable when we have these cyclical local food systems because the producers and the consumers are in spatial proximity to each other and they know each other. So in the Palo Puro case, we know exactly where the grain is from the moment it's grown to where it's processed because it's actually processed at the farm. And then the bread is baked with known people and then it's retailed to known people. Same with the organic chicken house that we have that's participating in the AES model. You can actually go to a supermarket in Helsinki and you can see the branded eggs from our hen house. So you know exactly where those eggs came from. You know how they were produced. You know who produced them. And you also know that that product is involved in a model which is supporting the circular economy. Palo Puro Village has been around for a very long time. And the main farm that we cooperate with has also been around for a very long time, several generations. But there's been a problem in the development of the Finnish countryside, and that is as the number of farmers goes down, the size of farms has gotten much, much, much larger. And so maybe 100 years ago, you would have a village that had, say, 50 farmers, and each farmer had a small farm. As the agricultural system tries to compete in the globalized market, you need larger and larger areas of land to be able to produce enough product to compete in the globalized food system. And then less and less people are wanting to actually be farmers, especially in the case of Palo Puro, because it is so close to two large urban areas. It's about 60 kilometers north of Helsinki and about 5 kilometers south of Hyvinkää. So it's really sandwiched between the capital region and then also, for a Finnish city, a fairly large urban settlement. So it's just on the fringes of the urban fabric. And that's caused a lot of out-migration within the actual village. So as the village has moved into the 20th century, fewer and fewer people have wanted to keep up their farming, which means the farmers that are remaining then either buy or rent the land that is still left in Palo Puro. And what this has kind of caused is what was colloquially termed a few years ago by MT Co is the 100 hectares of loneliness. So you have one farmer and he has 100 hectares and maybe he's producing enough wheat to sell on the global market, but where's the community? Now we have our lonely farmer, and that's not really a sustainable lifestyle. That doesn't create a very viable countryside to have these very, very large farms, but no community. So the reason that Palo Puro was started was because we have, like I said, there's that organic grain farm, which is really the center of the model. And at this organic grain farm, we had the problem of the 100 hectares of loneliness, one farmer. And he decided that he wanted to move to organic production, which is great. And then another farmer moved in down the road, an organic vegetable farmer. And then another farmer moved in, the hen house. So they got together and started figuring out a way that their farms could benefit each other. And the best way that they could see that their farms could benefit each other and create something that would help them to compete in a different way, besides just their food production, was the production of biogas. So that's how they all started making this circular economy. But then they're making biogas, but everybody's still lonely. So what do we do then? And that caused them to think about ways that they could reintegrate community into the actual farm space. So at this main vegetable farm, the main grain farm, there used to be a cow house because about 100 years ago when the farm was still small, they had milk production and grain production. But the organic milk market is tougher and tougher to compete, especially in southern Finland. So they didn't have cows anymore. They just had an empty cow house. And so they decided to renovate that cow house and use it as a social space for the village and the surrounding countryside, a place where people could gather and have kind of a keystone of the community to spend time. Because there really, at this point, there was no other space in the community where they could be expressing themselves that way, because the local school had closed. The local school closed, I believe, in about 2005. So, you know, we have this community that once used to be very much a standalone village with a lot of agricultural families that had, you know, their village schoolhouse, but now the school's gone and there was just no place. So they integrated the socio-cultural aspects into this AES model. And I bet you're wondering, how did we go from three farmers deciding to produce biogas and renovate a cowhouse to make a social space? How did we go from that to something as wordy as agroecological symbiosis that is connected to industrial symbiosis and, you know, these larger thoughts of the globalized food chain and relocalized food chain? Well, this is because these farmers, when they started this collaboration, they actually approached the University of Helsinki, and they knew one of the professors there, Juha Helinius, and they approached him and said, "Hey, we're doing some cooperation out on our farm. Why don't you come out and help us develop an actual formalized model around this? And let's do something with this that we can then share outside of just our context." So that's how we got the AES connection to the larger conversations about, you know, globalized food chains, localized food chains, circular economy. So that's how we have kind of the more academic end of this model. That's how it kind of came together. So one of the problems with situations like this is, where do we go from here? You know, this all sounds like a lot of personalities. So this is, at the moment, quite personality driven. You know, we have the exact farmers that are in the exact place, who have the will to make the social space, who have the expertise to be able to open a cafe, who have the willingness to approach the biofuel company. But how do we actually scale this? And do we want to scale this? That's maybe the first question. Should this be scaled up? What is scaling up a localized food system look like? And this is one of the questions that we're contemplating on the academic side of things. And one of the ways that we're contemplating it is what that scaling actually looks like. And what we've come to is that each individual AES type model shouldn't necessarily be scaled up, but we should create something that's reproducible, and in that way it can be scaled out. So it's not that we get a larger and larger circular system, it's that we get a network of localized systems that are whatever size they should naturally be given the context of the exact space and place where they're arising. For example, we have our second model, which is not quite a working model yet, but is looking to be a working model, which is happening in Mansala. And that model is a little bit larger. There's more players involved with that model, but it's because it's a larger town center there, and there's more players that make sense to be involved. But just because the actual configuration of the players is a different configuration, it doesn't mean it's not an AES, because it still integrates the biophysical goals of nutrient recycling and closing biomass loops, the circular economy goals of creating biofuel, and then it also has those sociocultural goals of creating a community within the rural area, so creating viability and livability in rural spaces. That's kind of how we view what scaling means in the context of an AES system. And then what's the future? What's the actual future? Like, what happens if our grain farmer decides that he wants to move to Spain next year, for example? What's going to actually happen to the system? And these are questions that we actually don't have answers for yet. And this is something that we're continuing to think about. But as the system gets more ingrained in place, and as the actors in the system get more used to being part of this model, and the biofuel plant, it's currently being built, the biofuel plant is built, you know, it starts to take on a life of its own. So while the initial spark for something like an AES really is personality driven, and there have to be people who have the willingness to engage in this transformation, we're hoping that once the transformation is underway, that it gets carried forward through its own momentum. And we're looking at kind of the promoters and barriers to that transformation being carried forward. So that's one of the things that we're actually looking at in this first working case at AES.